Our guest today is Martine Warmann. She is a UK BFF fitness competitor, and she recently won first place in the Bikini Masters and first place in the Bikini Open, and she intends to go on to get her pro card. She'll be competing again later this year at the British national level, and long term she hopes to go all the way to the Arnold. You may also recognize her from the TV show Ninja Warrior, and she's also been a European Powerlifting Champion in her weight category. If you want to find out more about Martine, you can go to her website, which is mumwarrior.com, and she specializes in helping women, and specifically mums, in losing body fat and obtaining the body shape that they desire. Also, our podcast sponsor is the European Hemp Company. Listeners of this podcast can get £10 off their CBD oil, as well as free shipping, when they use the code BenLarryPodcast at checkout. Just simply go to europeanhempcompany.co.uk. Also, if you're interested in property investing, I'm part of a joint venture group, and we're mentored by a coach called Alex Louise, and she's based in South Wales. And if you want to find out more about that, you can go to financialfreedomwithalex.com. If you know anybody who would make a good guest for this podcast, you can direct them to benlarry.com/podcast guest. And if you're interested in sponsoring the podcast, go to benlarry.com/sponsorship. Hey, Martine, welcome to the podcast.
Hi, thanks.
And congratulations on your big win yesterday. How'd you feel?
Amazing. Still buzzing. It's a good time to do it because I'm on a high still.
Yeah. Do you know what I love about this? By the way, let's tell the people exactly what you won. What was it?
I won. I've got them here. Look. Can you see? Uno. Number two.
Amazing.
I won first place Bikini Masters and first place Bikini under 164 centimetres. That's my height category. And I'm 160 centimetres. I'm Diddy.
So that was that the Leicester competition?
This was called the Northwest Championships, and it was in Warrington.
Okay, so that qualifies you now for the Nationals?
That qualifies me for the British Championships in October, which will be is the biggest comp of the year, and that's what all these qualifiers leading up to it are for.
Do you know what I love most about this, right? You did a competition 6 weeks ago and didn't place, yeah? And at the time, I thought, I mean, I would have probably just given up. I just presumed that you wouldn't bother like doing another one, or maybe do one next year or something. And I remember saying to you, what are you going to do? And you're like, oh, I'm doing another one in 6 weeks. And so tell us about that, like your thought process.
Well, my goal was I want to do the British champ. My overall goal is I want to turn pro. So there is no quitting. I just have to keep going until I get that. And then my logic was, these are the qualifying events. There's a number of them throughout the year. If I don't qualify at that one, I'm going to continue until I do qualify so that I could do the British and then keep going. So it wasn't nice to not place, but I just know there's another opportunity, so I'll go for it again.
That's so cool. I really love that. Like, from a mindset point of view, I mean, I'm a pretty positive, you know, goal-driven person. But
yeah.
But you just, I mean, you're just fixated on the goal, and you're just going to do whatever it takes to get it.
Yeah, I mean, there was a couple of girls in this competition. All the girls are always really, really nice. People always think it's going to be really, really bitchy, but it's not. You may get the odd fake, genuine, ungenuine person, but most of them are really, really nice. And there's a couple of girls that are really gutted that they didn't place in different categories to me. And I was just like, don't give up, because it was probably for some of them, it was their first competition. I'm like, just because you didn't place doesn't mean you weren't good enough. It's just that they chose a different look this time, or whatever the reasons are. Don't stop at one. Just keep going. If you want to do it, you've worked this hard already, you might as well keep going.
Is that your own attitude, or did some coach tell you that?
No, it's my own attitude, because I know what I want to work towards. I want to become a pro. You can't do that by just doing one show. So, and you're not going to win them all, or even place in them all. So that's just part of it.
That reminds me when I was watching American Idol once. Some guy came in with a bad attitude, and he was like, oh, I've been waiting all day. And they were like, look, if you want to be successful in the music industry, you're going to be doing a lot of waiting. Like, if you can't handle waiting to come into the audition, you're not going to. And it's the same with this, isn't it? Like, you need a lot of, what's the word?
Resilience. Like, you need to be both resilient. What else do they say? A little bit thick-skinned, because you can take your placing personally, and is based off someone else's opinion and what they're looking for right there and then, and based on that lineup. So you just have to, if your goal is to compete or to win whatever title, you just got to keep going until you get it, if that's what you want.
Yeah, I love that. That's really unique. I mean, I don't come across many people that are as clear-minded as you. But anyway, so people listening to this, I think they're going to want to know about your training and your diet and stuff. And by the way, we might as well just plug the fact that you do coach people as well, yeah?
Yeah, so I coach people, but I don't do competition prep, because there's a difference between wanting to lose weight and compete. They're completely different. I don't do that, because it's, you have to know about all the different federations, what they're looking for and everything else. And that's not really, that's not what I specialize in. But I do specialize in helping people lose weight. So if that's what they need, then they can come and see me for help. But in terms of my diet and training, I think people often think that, especially for a bikini competitor, that you just don't eat. And it's the opposite. You need to really eat well. And so mine is just very basic. It's, people always want to really massively overcomplicate things or do some special diet or follow someone's, whatever the biggest Instagram star is, whatever they're doing. But it's there's absolutely nothing to it other than I eat a mix of carbs, fats and protein in different amounts depending on how I'm looking. So if I was looking a bit flat, I'd probably have a bit more carbs. If I need to build more muscle, I need to add a bit more protein. For me, what works well is I deal with carbs quite well, so I do eat quite a lot of carbs and fats. So my nutrition will change every week depending on how I'm looking and what my coach wants. In terms of my training, again, that's just, it's simple, but it's high volume. So I do lighter weights than what I would normally use, because I like a lot of strength training. I don't really do that so much anymore. Light weights and very high reps. So it'll be 20 plus reps, lots of sets, probably 5 sets, sometimes 8 sets. And I train twice a week at a bodybuilding gym, 3 times at a CrossFit box. And that's purely because I train clients from there, so I'll do all the dumbbell stuff from there. I do most of my cardio from home because I've got my daughter a lot, so I'll do HIIT workouts at home or steady state cardio, which would be a long walk with her in the pushchair or 20 to 30 minutes on the bike. I don't do loads of cardio just because I just don't need to, for me, for my body shape. Not everyone does, but some people do. It's dependent on each person.
Why is volume training more appropriate for a competition than strength training like you used to do with powerlifting?
Some people do strength training through it. Everybody does it slightly different. But for me, what works well is just working high reps, really fatiguing the muscle. It's something that I don't normally do as well because I hate it. I'm a one rep max type person, and I just want to get things done as quickly as possible. But 5 sets of plus 20 reps, I just find it gives me a better shape, my muscle tone looks better, I get results quicker. That just works for me. Some people do strength training though.
Interesting. I don't think I ever tuned into my body to the same degree that you have. Like, I never really noticed any difference in the different styles of training, but I don't think I was really taking it to the level that you are. I mean, yeah, I just go through the motions a little bit, really. But
What training were you doing when you were competing for?
Well, I suppose I was doing a mix. I was still lifting heavy, I was still doing that, but I was also putting in sort of volume and higher reps as well. But I wouldn't have been able to say, like, I'd never noticed how my body responded to it, really. I never noticed, yeah. Do you know what I mean? I just did loads of weightlifting and just hoped for the best, really, is all I did.
I do a heavy session once a week, but that's only if I have the extra time, and that's purely because I just enjoy it. That's not really part of my training, but I just like to lift heavy. It just makes me feel good. But yeah, it's not really part of my training.
Yeah, it's a different feeling, isn't it? It makes you feel powerful. There's something really gratifying about lifting heavy.
Yeah, it is.
I don't know if it's like actually a chemical hormonal level or if it's just mental. I got no idea, but there is a difference, isn't there?
For sure, yeah. Because you feel, if you can see your weights increasing, like, it's visual, isn't it? You know you've made progress.
Yeah, I suppose it's that as well. And so you just mentioned the way that you fit your lifestyle around being a mum as well. So do you want to say a bit more about that?
Yeah, so Imani's not in nursery, so I have her pretty much full time apart from 2 days when my mum has her. So on those 2 days, I really max out as much as I can do. So I'll work, and that what I do for a living is I work with clients online and offline. So the people that I train offline, I train at a box. And so in between sessions waiting for them or afterwards, that is when I will fit in my training session. And I know people often ask me how long I train for and the days, but unlike before, I don't have set times or set days anymore. It's just if my husband's home for a little bit, he'll have a, and then I'll quickly go and do something. It's just it's kind of winged each week, but I have a plan, if that makes sense.
Yeah. So that you mentioned your long-term goal. What was it
To win a pro card, which means a professional athlete, and that means I could compete at the Arnold. There's amateur Arnolds and pro Arnolds, but the main thing is that Arnold himself is there and he gives out the award for the winner.
Mm. Wow. Oh, cool. So we're going to get a photo of you with Arnold, basically.
I would love that, because he's nothing that spells out bodybuilding other than him, is it?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, he's an icon, isn't he?
Yeah,
that's really cool. Hey, I just wanted to ask, your brother's been competing in CrossFit to a high level. So what's the latest news with that?
He is so close to qualifying for the games. And I don't know if you follow CrossFit, but out of CrossFit, the games is the only top place you can go. Like it's the best of the best of the best that go there. And so he's been trying to work towards this for a number of years. This is the closest he's got to it. Last year he was a regional athlete. They're not doing regionals anymore, so it's slightly harder, where whatever competition you're entering, you have to win it, and if you win it, you'll go through to the games. So he's got a competition coming up this weekend coming up, which I'm going to in Holland, and this will be the last opportunity this year he has to qualify for the games. If he wins it, and it's only the winner, then he'll be going, and then we'll all be going to the US for the Open. And I think the prize money is $250,000 or something.
Whoa.
Yeah.
So for the people listening, we're talking about Zach George. And I was teaching a handstand workshop in Watford in London.
Yeah, I know what you're going to say.
Yeah, some guys came along, and they were CrossFit guys, and they were talking about whatever the recent competition was, and they were talking about Zach George. I was like, oh, yeah, I know that guy. So that was cool. So he's sort of famous in that world, or at least in the British CrossFit world, isn't he?
Yeah, if you're into CrossFit, you would know who he is. Yeah.
So the two of you are now a very high level athletic family, but it didn't start that way, right?
No, it didn't at all. In fact, it started the same way that you and I met, because I went on to Tony Robbins UPW, and one of the reasons we did it is my dad did it, is because I was always sickly and weak. My brother was obese and overweight. He was he looks completely different. I'll send you an image if you want one. And we just went on that. We changed our mindset. We changed our eating habits. And then one thing led to the other. So we just started gaining knowledge and being really interested into it. And then me and my brother started running fitness classes together. Then we opened a gym. Then he opened a CrossFit box. And we both got into competing, first for me, powerlifting, then Ninja Warrior, and then he's always been into CrossFit, so he's always done that. And yeah, he just, one thing just led to the other, and we've just continued with it because we just both enjoy it.
What's the thing you enjoy most about, not just necessarily the training, but I know you do a regular radio spot, I know you run your coaching program for your clients and stuff online, and like, including the training, out of the whole thing, of your whole lifestyle, like, what's the bit you really enjoy that gives you the buzz the most?
I think it's not one thing. It's like it's a combination of all of it that comes together. Like, I love competing. I'm just very, very competitive person. I like to push myself. I like to push myself out of my comfort zone. I like a challenge. I actually find it very difficult just to train. Like, I have to have something going.
Oh.
To work towards something, and so that just keeps me going, and the better I do, the better I want to do, the further I want to go. And I love to be able to, I actually think it may stem from my dad always homing into me not to be average, and so I always try and do things that the average person may not do, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
If it's a chance to be on Ninja Warrior, I'm going to go for that. If whatever opportunities come to me, I want to say yes and I want to do it. And whatever I do, I want to do my best at. So I get a buzz of competing, so everything else is just required to for me to get that buzz. But I don't particularly enjoy high rep training. I don't particularly enjoy tracking my macros for food. I don't particularly enjoy packing everything you need for competition and going there and everything else, but I do enjoy every aspect of competing on that day and after that day, whether you do well or you don't, because if you don't do well, you get a bigger fire in your belly, you know what to improve on. If you do do well, you've got the buzz to keep going. So for me, it's a win-win, whether I win or lose.
Yeah, I totally understand. I think we got a similar nature like that, because I'm always driven by the desire to, I just never want to be average. Like, I always want to achieve something more than average, and
yeah,
and get and not just in comparison to other people, but just to get the best out of yourself as well, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. I think my brother-in-law described me on my wedding day as someone that likes to max out life, and I think that's, I probably wouldn't have said that about myself, but when he said that, I was like, actually, I do really try and max out all my opportunities, because you've only got one life to do it. You might as well see what you can do with it.
Yeah, I completely agree. Yeah, yeah, I think we're the same like that. Besides the going for the pro card, have you got other goals? I suppose I mean more broadly, more generally in your career, in your life. Like, is there other stuff?
I'd love to develop my brand, MumWarrior, to be a household name for mums. So like the Oprah Winfrey of mummy fitness, if you like. That would be a business goal. And my hobby, interest, everything else I do outside of life goal is to be to win my pro card.
Oh, I see. Yeah. Yeah, that makes sense.
Everything I do, though, is all related. It's all interconnected. So even my business life is pretty much my hobby. If you do that, like, I enjoy everything that I do and working towards.
Yeah, I can relate to that, because I'm the same. It's sometimes it's hard for people to understand, if because a lot of people, their lives is split in two, isn't it? They go to work and then they do sort of stuff they enjoy,
yeah,
after work or at the weekend. And like, when you're self-employed like we are, and we've got like our own personal brands, our websites, our businesses, we've got our lifestyles is a little bit similar, isn't it? And,
yeah,
it's all, there ain't really the same distinction. It's sort of all one thing, isn't it? Life is just constantly doing stuff you enjoy, working towards goals.
Yeah. And my family will be like, just, if for example, my mum's got money for a bit of extra time, she'd be like, just relax and chill and do something you enjoy. But for me, something I enjoy would be writing a client's program out. And so she sees it and sees me working, but I see that, no, I enjoy this. I want to do this. This is what I want to do with my time.
Yeah, I'm the same as that. Actually, I was chatting to my housemate earlier. We were saying the same thing. Because I don't, like, personally, I'm not going to speak for you, but with me, I don't even like going on fucking holiday. I can't stand sitting around.
I love holidays.
You like it? Yeah, I thought you did.
I love a holiday.
That's why I caveated it. But yeah, for me, I don't want to go to, I remember Gary Vee saying the same thing as well. He was like, I don't want to sit in a beer garden. I don't want to go skiing. I don't want to walk around a fucking museum. I enjoy, you know, doing my Gary Vee thing, running my business, hustle, whatever it is. Yeah, it's cool.
But for me, a holiday is an opportunity to do holiday workouts. I can still, you know, I can still fit in, and people be like, well, how do you keep fit on holiday? Let me show you.
Right. There's a product in that.
Hey,
there's a product in that.
Exactly. There's content in it. There's, I can make two out of one. I can have a holiday and enjoy it. I can also work. I can also film some workouts. I can get content in. So it's not, I wouldn't go on a holiday and just do nothing. I would use the landscape, the weather, whatever I've got, basically, to help with business and to keep me fit.
Yeah, photo shoot.
Exactly.
So, like, you aim yourself at mums, but, like, the people that join your coaching program, like, tell us about it. What's involved? What's included? What do people get?
So, I do attract mostly mums. I think it's because people follow me and just motherhood, basically, and what I do with the Marnie and how she eats and everything else. And I do have a group which is just for mums, which is Mum Warriors and Mum Warrior Tribe members. So with Mum Warriors, you can join for free. Just enter your email address in the website and they get a free workout every week, which is designed for busy mums. So whether you've got 5, 10, 15, 20 minutes, you can do the workout and you can set the time that you want to work out at. And then Mum Warrior Tribe members is for those that want a little bit more. So they can join on a membership basis and they've got access to all my workouts, nutrition programs. They get weekly coaching and everything else in the private group. But then I also attract not necessarily just mums, but women in general. I don't really work with men. I will make the odd upset exception from time to time, but I just prefer to stick with women. So women that I've been attracting recently, funnily enough, is CrossFit women that have already got their training down. CrossFitters work out. They work out with intensity, that they already know how to burn fat through the workouts. They know how to lift correctly. They've got the exercise down, but they don't always have the nutrition down. And the thing with CrossFit boxes is it's focused very much on the workouts. And so a habit that CrossFitters tend to have is they're fueling their workouts, but not with the correct food. And so they don't have the desired shape that they want. And actually, they've recently been coming to me and wanted to not necessarily lose weight, but just look better and be healthier. So I don't know how that's happened, probably from posting that I'm at the box or from Zach, or I don't know. But I've recently been getting women that want to just look healthier and better rather than mums. And that's one-to-one coaching, though. That's not through group coaching.
What is it they're doing? Is it because they're eating too much?
They're eating too much of the wrong foods and thinking they may burn it off with the workouts, and they're not. So it's just, you know, normally when you join a gym, there would be like a PT service or something where you, some weight loss product or something. They get help in different ways if they want to. At a CrossFit box, you literally walk into a box with a rig and weights and everything else. And that's it. So if you don't know about nutrition, if you don't know how to eat correctly, and you only go to a box, you don't really get the information on, other than the paleo diet, which is what they tend to follow. That's not even pushed in boxes, really. You've been to the box. There's no frills in terms of a reception area or food that you can buy or drinks. And maybe it's some boxes. Zach's got a couple of things, but it's not like a conventional gym. So a lot of people go there and use the box. They may go to a separate gym to do a different type of training if they need machines, and they may reach out to other people for help with nutrition, which is what I found of late.
So if someone's working out hard, they're already strong, they're already doing all that, but they've got too much body fat and they want to look more aesthetic, that's where you could help them.
Yeah, or they just want to change their shape a little bit, because depending on your body shape, CrossFit can make you your shape a certain way. It's very top heavy, so they often have quite dominant traps. And some of them just want a slightly more feminine shape, not necessarily lose weight, just shape and change a little bit. And also some people just want the education on nutrition, on how to eat healthier, how to fuel yourself for your workouts without having to have 40 coffees beforehand or a pre-workout. Mm-hmm. They just want a different idea. Not everyone wants to follow paleo way of eating either.
So I'm going to confess, right, this is a bit embarrassing for me, because like I've never actually measured or weighed any food or any calories, and I wouldn't even know where to start. Like if I'm weighing rice, is that like before you put it in the water? I literally don't know. I'm not kidding you. Like just talk me through it.
That's all right. Just that you don't have to do those things. That before I'd compete in bikini, I wouldn't track macros, calories, nothing. Not because I don't know how to, just because I know how to balance my food without having to track it. The only reason I started tracking it is because to compete, it needs to be quite dead on. So you need to know exactly how much of each thing you're eating. And if anyone's working towards a particular goal, like, did you have a set food plan that you're having for when you were competing?
No. I think I probably should have done, but no, Jada just had me going on how I felt. And so, no, I didn't.
Because normally, if someone's not tracking what they're eating, it's because they're being told exactly what to eat.
Right.
I hate the inflexibility of that, because I already know what type of foods to eat, especially because I don't eat meat. So I need to know exactly of what carb, fat, protein I'm eating. But yeah, to answer your question, it's so easy these days because of all the apps and technology you've got available to you. You could download MyFitnessPal, for example, and you don't need to worry about whether you're weighing it dry or cooked for your rice, for example. You could just put in, you've had a cup full, and in your app, it's so good. It will say dried weight, cooked weight, cup weight, per gram, whatever you've got, you can select the option and it will tell you how many carbs, fats and proteins have been in that. So you can put in your stats within the app, and you can track exactly what you're eating. And the good thing with it is, if you, like for yourself, you're not sure on it, everything's got a barcode on it. Most things that you will eat have a barcode on it. So if you don't know what to put in your app, you just scan the barcode and it will come up, and you just select the quantity that you've had, and it will tell you the breakdown of each macro, calorie, everything.
Wow, I didn't realize that. Okay, yeah, I've never actually done that. So interesting. Do you ever eat, what's your policy on sugar and treats and chocolate?
Normally, I will have a treat every single week, and it will be different every week. It's just whatever I fancy. Sometimes it's not that I want junk, it's just that I want to eat. Like, for example, after this competition, I had a set meal planned. However, the biggest thing is, like, I've got a week off now, is knowing that I can just eat what I want without having to worry about tracking it in an app. And that, it doesn't mean I'm going to go mental and eat a load of crap all week. It just means that, for example, I love things like apple and nut butter, but to have that on prep, I'd have to have the exact amount of nut butter, and the apple takes up a lot of your carbs, so I'd probably have something else instead. Now I could eat three apples and just dip it in almond butter and eat it at my leisure. I'm not eating anything bad, but I just want to eat a quantity of what I want that will satisfy me. But yeah, I just believe in flexibility. So you need a weekly treat to keep you going. Most people, there are the odd couple of clients, for example, that just cannot have a drip of extra sugar at the weekend, because if they do, it will just make them fall off track. Everybody's different. I personally like to work towards that treat meal, have it, and then continue with my plan.
How many calories were you on, like, during your prep?
I focused on macros, but it does calculate it for you in the app, so I was aware of roughly what my calories were. The lowest I had was 1,200 calories, which isn't low. If you think about what most people do when they're trying to lose weight, is they will go from eating, not knowing how many calories they're eating, which will be more than they think if they're overweight, to suddenly dropping to, they'll just Google how many calories should a woman have, and it'll come up 1,200 calories, which is not correct. It's dependent on you. They'll drop straight to that. They'll shoot their metabolism in the foot, and then they'll lose weight for a little bit, then they'll get stuck. And then when they stop doing that, they'll gain a lot of weight, which is totally not the right way of doing it. And I think when it comes to bikini and competing, people think you just have zero calories, and you can't do that because you've got nowhere to go when you do that. So the lowest I went to was around 1,200 calories. And on the last week of the competition, I think it was like 3 days before, I was having 240 grams of carbs, which is a lot of carbs in a day.
Just roughly, how many calories would you have been eating when you were competing at powerlifting?
I never measured it. So my normal diet, probably 1,600 calories, 1,600 to 1,800.
All right. So it wouldn't have been, it wouldn't have been over 2,000 then, probably.
No, but maybe on a treat day.
Yeah, I see. Okay, so when's the next show then?
Next show, I'm undecided because the qualifiers are done for me anyway. Now I'm qualified, I don't need to worry about doing another qualifier. So the championships, British champs, are in October. However, there is a really big competition in June where I have the opportunity to win a pro card. I have the opportunity twice to win a pro card, actually, by two different categories. However, that's in 4 weeks, and I would like to spend the time, I've just done a blog on this actually before this, I'd like to spend the time on making a considerable amount of changes to my body for October rather than going in again in 4 weeks' time. There's not going to be that much difference.
So what do you want to do different then?
Build bigger shoulders and build more defined glutes.
Okay, and then how do you define your glutes?
So I will train glutes only 4 to 5 times a week, but it just takes time. So I had 6 weeks to make improvements for the last one, but the improvements that I can make from now until October, nothing massively will change with my workouts. I just need to keep the consistency going, will be a lot different. So I just need the time, basically, to make those changes.
What, so by doing a lot of volume on a body part, that'll make it more defined, will it?
Yeah, so a mistake people make is they just think they need to squat. But particularly for women, most people don't activate their glutes properly. So a squat will work your glutes if you know how to activate them. But if you're not activating them, what will happen is you'll build your legs, your quads, more than anything else. And so for glutes to grow, particularly, so you've got, everyone wants a different shape, but I don't particularly care for the bubble, but I just want more definition there. So I would do glute thrusts. I would do any isolation exercises. So I'm only working my glutes. So I've got no choice but to activate them. So lots of stuff with bands, resistant bands, glute thrusts. You can go heavy. You can do lightweight weights, heavy, lots of reps. It's dependent on your training. But doing isolation exercises for that one muscle group.
Oh, I see. And then you'll see more separation with all the different sort of what they called muscle heads or something.
Yeah, so the main thing that most women don't want, they don't want to get thick thighs, but they want a big bum. But if you carry on squatting, you're not activating your glutes, your work, it's a compound movement, so it's not just working one muscle. So if you don't want thick thighs or you don't want to work your legs, you would just work your glutes. Same for me, I want bigger shoulders, but if I just train a body part per week, it's always going to be in proportion. If I train shoulders, which I'll do now, four times a week instead of just once, I'm going to get a bigger difference. Do you know what I mean?
Right. So for you, delts and glutes is what you're after more of, is it?
Yeah, front delts, rear delts, basically a bigger cap here. Just because from looking at the pros, that they look for an X shape, or some people call it a V shape. Bigger and wider shoulders make your waist look even smaller, and then to even out your body, if you've got nice big round toned glutes, that also helps. So that's generally the look. And I have a very, very small frame, so I need to basically build my shoulders to make me look a bit bigger, especially if I'm up against people that are taller than me, so that I have a stronger stage presence.
Yeah. I'd imagine, like, for women, glutes is like the holy grail. That must be what a lot of women want, isn't it, when they come to you?
Most of my clients just want to lose weight, to be honest. Right. And then from there, they'll take it from there. But those that are already fit tend to want bigger glutes.
Is now an opportunity to talk about yoga, do you think?
What for?
Put you on the spot there, haven't I?
No, you that doesn't like yoga.
It's me that doesn't like yoga. Hey, throwing me under the bus. I can't fucking stand yoga.
You're not gonna build a booty with yoga.
There you are, she said it, so I didn't have to. Do you hear that? Yeah, why not? Go on, give us some technical stuff to legitimize our prejudice.
Well, you know, it depends what you're trying. Not everyone wants bigger glutes, but even if you just want more definition, when you train with weights, it shortens your muscles, so that makes them look more defined and more full. When you're doing yoga, nothing wrong with it, but it lengthens your muscle. So if your goal is to build more muscle, look more defined, then you're counteracting what your goal is by doing yoga, which will lengthen your muscles, make you more flexible, and it has its purpose, but not always for weight loss or for building muscle. There's just better, more quicker, effective ways to do it.
Hey, is your brother going to do like modeling and stuff? Because he looks good, doesn't he?
Yeah, he does. You know, and my coach always like, he's always wants to get him into bodybuilding, but that is not his thing at all. He's got a bodybuilder shape more than a CrossFitter shape. Like, he's designed to be a bodybuilder. He just doesn't want to do it. He does do a bit of modeling for his sponsors and stuff, but it's not really his thing. He's just so focused on his goal, which is to win the CrossFit Games. So if anything else comes with it, he'll do it, but as long as it doesn't take him away from his overall goal.
Yeah, that makes sense. That's fair enough. But it's interesting, isn't it? Like, if he wanted to do bodybuilding, he'd clean up, wouldn't he? I mean, he's got a great shape, but it's interesting, isn't it? He's got the potential, but if it doesn't interest him, then...
Yeah, and he loves his food. Like, he's not good. That's what... He weighs so much for a CrossFitter. Like, he needs to be lighter, so he can be faster at certain things, especially gymnastics. But he loves his food. He's always loved his food. Now he just eats the right type of food, so he can actually get away with eating a lot. And he needs to eat a lot to fuel his workout. So he's not gonna do bodybuilding. He's not gonna want, especially for him as a bodybuilder, he'd be fine on the food to a point. But when it comes to the bit where you need to be lean up for stage lean, at the last week, he's not gonna do that.
Like, with the amount of energy he's outputting, can he get away with eating junk and sugar and whatever he wants?
He does eat junk, but he'll eat that once a week, like a treat meal. But he could get away with it, but he does store fat quite quickly, so he wouldn't be able to out train it for very long, because he does train for about 4 hours a day, and it's very intense. He'll train like 2 hours in the morning, 2 hours in the evening. Like, he trains like an athlete, but he does eat like one, so he won't eat crap during the week. He'll eat a lot of food, but it's not rubbish.
How many calories do you reckon he's eating?
God knows, a phenomenal amount. Like, he's the worst person to go out for a meal with, because he'll order 3 starters, 2 mains, 4 desserts on a weekend anyway. So when he's splitting the bill, you're like...
So I'm guessing, he must be like 4,000 or 5,000 calories a day, do you reckon?
It wouldn't surprise me. I've never asked him, to be honest, but yeah, he puts away a lot of food. Like, if you're snacking on a whole chicken, you're eating a lot.
Yeah, cool, that's great. Did you meet any cool people at your recent yesterday's competition?
Do you know what? I did. I've met her before because she's one of the judges. But when they gave out the awards, they always have someone to do it, either some kind of special guest or a previous competitor that's done very well. And for the first category that I did, do you remember the show Gladiators?
Yeah.
I loved that show. Like, super fan, loved Gladiators. And one of the judges is Panther from Gladiators. Mm-hmm. Her real name is Helen. She's on the judging panel. And she actually gave the award. When she gave me the award, she's like, oh, well done. I was like, oh my God, I got an award from Gladiator. Because I just, you know, when you're like a little bit, what's the word, starstruck, when mm-hmm. you want to ask all these questions, you're like, no, I can't be that person. She's also a judge. I can't ask. Mm-hmm. But yeah, just for me, that was like the coolest person.
Did you go for feedback? Did they say about your shoulders with the feedback?
They didn't say that, but that's my personal goal. But I will get feedback when I go and see my coach.
I see. What else is that's another question in my mind. I forgot what it was. Tell us about your coach.
So I've got two. I've got a lovely lady called Alison Bucker, and she does my nutrition. And the reason I have a nutrition coach, because my clients ask me, why do you have a coach, is because I believe anyone that achieves anything always has someone else to help them do it. She's my coach simply because if I was to do my nutrition plan, I would change things all the time. And how I view myself is different to how someone else views me. And what I'm going for is different to how someone else is trying to get me to my goal. So it's easier to have someone else just tell you, this is what you need to do and do it. We work very similar. So she knows me. I've known her for a long time. She knows my health ethics, if you like. And therefore, she literally just provides me with my macros and I stick to that. And then she'll tweak it according to how I'm looking and from my check-ins. She used to be a powerlifter. She still is a powerlifter. She does a lot of strong women stuff. And she also competes in, I think they call it figure, which is like bikini, but you've got to have a lot more muscle. So it's not like bikini at all. It's a different category, but that's what she does. She's my coach. And my other coach who does my training, so I'll see him twice a week and then I'll do my own training. He trains me twice a week at his gym called Sugar's Gym, and he's a well-known bodybuilder. He came sixth in the world, so he knows his stuff. He's an old-school bodybuilder. You're not going to get any fancy written PDF plans or any videos or online coaching apps. He's just going to tell you how it is and you're just going to get on with it. And I love that because it's just straight to the point, no messing. I know exactly what I'm going to do. So I feel like I've got the best people. And then I've also have someone to help me with my posing, and she is an IFBB pro. So she's great because she will show you how to pose and give me tips based on my best qualities so they can make it stand out a little bit more. And she's great. Her name's Phoebe Hagen. She competes worldwide. She's really good. And I had two sessions with her. So I don't really work with her as such. I just go to her for tips. And I book in a session with her. It's all done online. She lives in Brighton. Never met her, even though I've been following her for a little while. So she really knows her stuff, and she's great at posing. Yeah, and she gave me some really good tips for this comp, especially because my nutrition coach doesn't do that. My training coach, I don't think he'd be comfortable with telling me how to get my booty to pop. So I wanted to get someone else's point of view.
What's the guy's name?
Sugar. Oh. They call him Sugar.
Yeah, nice. Do a lot of competitors have three coaches like that? Is that standard?
I think it depends, you know. I just like to seek out the best, and I use different people for different things. So Alison was my go-to for nutrition because I've known her for a long time on Trista. Sugar is a family friend. He's part of the UK BFF. He knows how it works. He has a gym. It's fairly close for me to get to. He knows his stuff. Chose him. And I've only really started working with Phoebe recently, and that it's not like a separate coach, if you like. It's just someone you can just ask for advice or something. But I guess everyone does things differently. Most people will have a coach that do it, and not all coaches do training and nutrition, so some may have two. Sugar doesn't do nutrition anyway, so I would, even whatever I chose, I'd have to choose someone else for that.
What's your attitude towards drugs? Because that's something people always want to know, isn't it? Is all the women on stage, are they taking drugs? Like, what's your view of that?
Bikini competitors don't need to take drugs at all. No one needs to take drugs, and not everyone's on drugs either. There's such a stigma with it that everybody that looks good is on drugs or used a filter, and that's not the case. There are natural athletes out there still. And I don't think it's necessary to take drugs. I wouldn't do that because it hinders your health anyway. For me, it's pointless. What is the point? If your goal, for example, is to win a pro card, what's the point of getting there and then dropping dead the next day because you've been doing ridiculous things to get there? Even if you've not been taking drugs, if you've just been ridiculous with your diet and just giving yourself a heart attack, because you never really have a heart attack, you attack your heart by doing ridiculous things like stupid diets or taking whatever you're taking. For me, it's completely pointless. My reason to staying healthy is for myself and for my daughter, so I'm not going to do anything that hinders that, and that's drugs as well. I don't care if that's your choice to do it. That's your business, not mine. It's just I wouldn't do it personally.
Does it get, like, do you think you can visually tell when someone's doing it? Like, I get the sense you probably don't care because you're just focused on what you want to do, but do you think you can tell?
I think you can tell with women more so than with men.
Why is that?
Because drugs do terrible things to women. Right. Like, they've got body hair in places they shouldn't have it. They've lost hair from places they should have it. Their voice shouldn't be that deep and changed a lot. It changes their shape too, and they tend to have a very similar looking body. They just become more manly, and some people, it's, for some women, it's quite obvious, even if they're using very, very small amounts. For men, it's getting more and more difficult to tell between those that are using and those that aren't, because there are people that are using it and don't do anything with the training, just think it's like a magic pill and look crap, so you wouldn't think they're on it, and they are. The ones that have a phenomenal body and they look ripped and jacked that aren't taking anything, but you think they would because of how good they look. So it's quite different with men. My brother doesn't take anything, but he looks like he would because he's got a really, really good shape. So it's really difficult. But a common telltale sign is very spotty back, bad skin, random hair patches, bloated stomach. I don't know. It's difficult with men.
Yeah. Yeah, interesting. It's one of those kind of gossipy kind of things, like, that people... It's interesting because it's speculative, isn't it? Because no one really knows who's on it, and there's always a frenzy of gossip around it, isn't it? Because the athletes don't admit they're doing it if they are.
Yeah, and do you know what as well? There is a lot of gossip about drugs and whether they're using it, and people slating people that do, and people slating people that don't. But at the end of the day, even if you're a top athlete and you look amazing, even if you're on the drugs will do so much. If you're absolutely massive, but you still have to work like an absolute bitch to look like that. It's not like they've just injected themselves and they're bam, got an amazing body. They've still worked their ass off. Not as hard as someone who isn't on drugs, but still, they've still worked super hard. So whether you slate them or not, there's still a lot of work that's gone in.
I imagine your brother probably gets accused just because the way he looks, because he's got so much muscle, hasn't he? Do people...
Yeah, because don't forget, people are judging from either a 15 to 30 second clip on a video or just seeing one post, but they haven't got the full picture or full information to know that actually he used to be fat. And his journey has not happened like that just because you're seeing it on his Instagram profile, and he may not post about how he used to look before because he doesn't actually bang on about it. But they haven't realised that he's been doing this since he was 12, not CrossFit, but looking after his body. He's lost a lot of weight, and then he was skinny, and then he was trying to build muscle, and that's happened. He's now 28. This has been going on since he was 12. You could do the maths, because I'm very good at that. So he's been doing it for a long time. It's not been a quick journey. So when people go, yeah, that person's on drugs because they've seen someone who looks good and jacked, actually, that's taken a lot of time and a lot of effort to get there. So it's not always a case that someone just took drugs. You've got to know the full picture and the full story. And people don't care to ask because they're fucking lazy.
Mm. Yeah. Wow. Good stuff. Well done, you.
Thanks. To summarise, well done.
So you're training today as well?
No, today's obviously bank holiday, but I'm working, getting a lot of work done. And Marnie's with my mum until later on, so I'm going to max out my time, get all my client stuff done so I can have a chilled evening, because I will be having Prosecco tonight. I'm just going to work out what I'm going to do, what competition I'm doing next, and then I'm probably going to take this whole week just to just chill.
Yeah. What about the photos? Are there photos coming through?
Yeah, I ordered the professional ones, so they'll be available in the next couple of days, and I'll start posting them out. No doubt, start spamming people.
Yeah. Great stuff. Well done. That's awesome. I'm pleased for you.
Thank you, Ben.
All right. I'll let you get on with your busy schedule.
Yeah, what have you got planned?
I think I'm going to go to the gym and just do cardio. I like...
What do you do for cardio? Just cardio?
I go on the stepper and I've been doing an hour. I don't know if that's what you'd recommend, but I just enjoy getting a sweat up and getting into it and just, you know, getting into the, listening to music, you know, that thing.
Yeah. Like your gym though. It looks pretty cool.
What?
Your gym's pretty cool though, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a great gym. I'm so lucky because I moved from Bristol to Newport and I joined the local leisure centre where all the old grannies go. And it was all right. And then I never knew about this one and someone recommended it. And I went in just on the off chance just to have a look and see what it was like. And it's the best gym ever. It's fucking massive. They got loads of studios. They got like yoga studio, dance studio, spitting studio.
Perfect for yoga.
Huh?
Perfect for you to do yoga there, then.
Can't stand fucking yoga. I'm never going to yoga. Yeah, they got a massive functional space. They got all the bars. They got everything. It's really nice. They haven't got a sauna, though. That would be cool.
Yeah, what have they got then? A steamer or a jacuzzi or any of that?
No, they haven't. They've got the space, though. So, yeah, they should. But
those things are expensive when you have them in.
Yeah, is it? Yeah, I suppose it is, isn't it?
A lot of maintenance.
But I feel lucky. I feel lucky because it's such a cool place. I feel right at home there. And they got a cafe and they got all the prepped meals in Tupperware in the fridge. Yep. And you can just sit and they'll just microwave it and you can just sit and eat it.
Do you editing?
Yeah. What do you mean? Like work and stuff?
Yeah. Take your laptop, go to the gym, have your meal, do some work.
Yeah, it's too good. It's too good to be. Yeah, I do. I take my iPad. I do my spreadsheets because I like
spreadsheets. Yeah, of course you do.
Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah, I do my emails. I do my hen party stuff. Yeah, I love it. It's great. I like it.
Cool. Mm. Well, enjoy your cardio session.
All right. Okay. I'll leave you to it.
We'll see you soon.
All right. Bye, Martine.
Bye.